Shall we start?
Okay. So I will share my. Okay. So. Okay. So today this is the last course. We will conclude this course on trace methods in random matrix theory by considering matrices which are have only a finite number of non-zeros and entries on each line, and the iconic example of this matrix ensemble is the uniform the adjacency matrix of the uniform regular graphs. So I will spend the most of the time today on this example, and then I will give you some extensions or some results which are connected to the techniques I will present here, which I will explain you in the case of the uniform regular graph. Okay. So regular graph is a graph where all degrees are the same, and the set of deregular graphs is non-empty with n vertices is non-empty if nd is even and d is between 2 and n minus 1. Okay, so this set is non-empty, so we will consider a uniform deregular graph, meaning that we sample, we take a random graph which is sampled according to the uniform distribution of this set. These are labeled vertices, so the vertex set is fixed, is 1 to n. Okay. So we can consider the adjacency matrix of a deregular graph. So we put a 1 or a 0, and we put a 1 if the entry between the vertex x and y is 1, and 0 is if the entry between x and y, if there is an edge between x and y, and 0 is otherwise. Since the graph is deregular, d would be an eigenvalue of the graph because each row sum exactly to d. Okay, and we will denote by non-decreasing order the eigenvalues. Lambda 1 is the largest one, lambda n the smallest one. So I recall you that the definition of the empirical distribution of eigenvalues, which is it's just sum of the Dirac mass at the eigenvalue, so it's a real probability measure. And we have already computed the spectrum, the analog of the empirical distribution, empirical spectral distribution in the case of an infinite deregular tree. So mu d is a spectral measure of the infinite deregular tree. So this is a measure whose moments counts are the powers, encode the powers of the adjacency operators of the deregular tree. So by that, so the power of this spectral measure, mu d, is just counting the number of closed paths of length k of a given length, for starting and ending at a given vertex x. Since the graph is transitive, it doesn't depend on the choice of the vertex you take. Okay, and as we already saw, that this measure has an explicit formula, and the support is minus 2 square root of t minus 1, 2 square root of t minus 1. Okay, so this was case 10. We did that in 59. At the beginning of the 80s, Brennan and Mackay, in fact, rediscovered this independently of case 10, rediscovered this matrix mu d, and Mackay proved the following theorem. Points of deregular graphs on n vertices, such that the number of cycles of a given length L is small compared to n, the total number of vertices. Okay. So the small, the little of n here depends on L, obviously. Okay. Then the empirical spectral distribution of such graph, of the adjacency matrix of such graph, will converge to this Kesten distribution mu d. Okay. And it's an exercise to check that you can apply this theorem to, for example, a uniform deregular graph on n vertices, or any graph whose, or for example, any graphs whose girth, meaning the smallest cycle in the graph, goes to infinity. Okay, so we will prove this theorem by the moment method, but unlike for Wigner's result, the proof will be essentially straightforward. Okay, so this is a simulation of what you see when you take d equal to 4 and agree from the sample graph. Okay, so the proof is just one slide. So you call CL the number of cycles of legs at most L in your graph, in your regular graph with n vertices. Okay, so you just observe that if a vertex X is far from any cycle of legs 2k, far meaning a distance at least k, then if you look at the ball of radius k around your vertex X in the graph, then it's isomorphic to the ball of radius k in the derregular tree, in the infinite derregular tree, because if there is no cycles, your derregular graph is exactly a tree, the derregular tree. So in particular, since the ball of radius k is exactly the same as the ball of radius k in the graph, in the infinite graph T, in the infinite derregular graph, the moments match, okay? And the moments of the for the adjacent operator on the infinite derregular tree are precisely encoded by this Kästen measure. And the number of bad vertices, meaning the number of vertices where you don't, such that their ball is not of radius k, is not is different from the ball of radius k of the infinity regular tree, is at most ck, the total number of cycles, and then you must be at distance at most k from one of the vertices of the cycle, so it's like ck times k times d minus 1 power k. Okay. And then you get that the normalized trace of your adjacent symmetric power k, you compare it to the moments of the Kästen distribution, and it will be bounded by the 1/1 of it. This sum, you write it as a sum of our vertices. The sum consists precisely exactly when the k neighborhood match. And when they do not match, it's the difference at most d power k, so you get the Kästen theorem, the McKay theorem, sorry. So you see, it's more straightforward than the semicircular law. Okay. In fact, there is another very nice result, and due to Allon and Bopana in the 80s, which says that in fact, recall that 2 square root of d minus 1 is the spectral radius of the adjacency operator of the infinity regular tree. This bound says that any irregular graph will have its second eigenvalue at least of order 2 square root of d minus 1 minus little o of 1 correction. Okay. I will not give you the proof of this result. I will prove a weaker result, but so the way both proofs, they start the same, it's the same idea. So it's the idea of the universal covering tree. Okay. So what is this object? So you take a graph, you pick a vertex of this graph, you call it G. And you consider a graph, an infinite tree, whose vertices are the set of non-backtracking paths starting from your root vertex O. Okay, so non-backtracking meaning that xi minus 1 is different from xi plus 1. And then you connect two non-backtracking paths of length, if one is the largest prefix of the order, of the other. So one is like x0 up to xk, and the other one is x0, xk, xk plus 1, okay? And so it's simpler to get on the picture. You take O to be the black vertex on the top of the on the graph of the left-hand side. And what you do is, so you there are two, if you want to start a non-backtracking path, either you go to the green or to the red vertex. Okay, and then it will give you the first layer of this tree. And then for the second layer, if you if the number tracking path was starting like black and red, then you can either go blue or green vertex, and so and you continue like that forever. Okay, so this is a universal covering tree. It's universal in the sense that it does not depend on the choice of the root vertex that you have chosen in G. And it's, there is a, another definition which explains more why it is universal, in which it is universal. Okay, but we don't need that here. Okay, so the weaker result that I will prove is the fact that the largest non-trivial eigenvalue in absolute value is bounded by is at least 2 square root of d minus 1. Okay, so the maximum of lambda 2 and the absolute value of lambda n. Okay, so the only comment to make is that if your graph is a d-regular, the universal covering tree of the graph is the infinite d-regular tree. Okay, because the covering tree is a tree. And since this operation of coverings preserves the degrees, so it has to be the uniform, the infinite d-regular tree. Okay, but since it's a universal covering tree, the number, if you have a closed walk of length k in the for starting, if you have a closed walk in the infinite d-regular tree starting from the root, then you can map it back to a closed walk in the base graph G. Okay? If you think about this picture again, if you have a closed walk starting from the root vertex of the tree on the right-hand side, okay, you can map it back to a closed walk on the left-hand side. Okay? And they are closed, but the reciprocal is not true. There are closed walk on the left-hand side, which are not closed walk on the right-hand side. It just means that you start at the black, for example, vertex, and you end at the black vertex. Okay, so since you have this inequality of number of closed walks of a given length, you have an inequality of the trace, okay? Which is comparing directly 1 over n trace of a to zk to the case moment of the Kesten measure. And since you have an explicit formula for the Kesten measure, it's trivial to find a lower bound for this case moment. And then you just recall that the trace is the sum of the eigenvalues, that d power k will be, d is an eigenvalue, but all the other ones are bounded by this lambda star. You optimize over the choice of k, log n, and you obtain a bound which is not as good as the one I've given you, but which is going to zero. Okay. So that's the idea of the Allon-Bopanna lower bound, is that d-regular graphs, their universal cover is an infinite, the infinite d-regular tree, and you automatically deduce from that some lower bounds on second largest eigenvalues. Okay, this motivates the definition of Ramanujan graphs. The fact that the smallest eigenvalue of the adjacency matrix of a d-regular graph is minus d is equivalent to saying that g is bipartite. Okay, it's the same as it follows from the Perron-Frobenius theorem. Okay, and so the largest non-trivial eigenvalue is the maximum of all of absolute values of eigenvalues which are different from d in absolute value. Then you say that the graph is Ramanujan if lambda star is less than 2 times square root of d minus 1, okay? So Ramanujan means just that the non-trivial eigenvalues are bounded by the spectral radius of the adjacency operator of the universal covering tree. Okay, so if you write it like that, you can have a definition of Ramanujan graph on any graph, not necessarily d-regular. And it turns out that for the spectral radius of the adjacency operator of the universal of the infinite d-regular tree is 2 square root of d minus 1. Okay, so existence of Ramanujan graph is a very delicate issue which has been solved in full generality only by Marcus Spielmann and Srivastava in 2015. But what we will be interested in this here is a conjecture by Allon, which has been proved by Friedman, which says that in fact almost all regular graphs are close to be Ramanujan in the following sense. But if you take a sequence of uniformly distributed irregular graphs on n vertices, then with high probability, the largest, the all eigenvalues except the largest one, d, are bounded by 2 square root of d minus 1 up to a vanishing term, a little over 1 culture. Okay, so even if it's very difficult to find explicitly a Ramanujan, to construct explicitly large Ramanujan graphs, in fact, it turns out that almost all regular graphs are almost Ramanujan. And I will sketch for you a proof of Friedman's theorem, which is not the proof, which is not different from the proof of Friedman, and which allows to have, to, for example, to have an explicit bound on this little law of one term. Okay. This, so there is a long gap. There were more than 20 years between Allen conjecture and the proof, and the reason is in the following slides, is that the I-trace method does not work. So I will try to explain you that. So take A to be the adjacency matrix of the of a Dirichlet graph. Okay, so if you want to use the I-trace method, you want to prove that the trace of A power K should be bounded by, so there is d power k, because there is a lambda, d is an eigenvalue, and all the rest is bounded by n times 2 square root of d minus 1 plus little over 1 power k. And you should prove that for k much larger than log n. So we already saw why you have to prove that for k much larger than log n. If you prove it for k much larger than log n, then it implies Friedman's theorem. Okay, so you can, it's the fact that there is an eigenvalue 1, d is an eigenvalue, so what you can do is to project on the orthogonal of the eigenvector, the eigenspace associated to eigenvalue d, which is the constant vector, the eigenvector just with all ones, and what you could try to do is to bound the trace of A minus the matrix where all entries are equal to d over n power k. Okay, so you want to prove such bound, and if you believe in Fioretti and Kermlach bound, you want to prove this bound in expectation. Okay, that's what we did up to now to prove the Fioretti and Kermlach theorems, bounds on spectral radius of non-backtracking matrices, and so on. That's always the path that we followed. But the problem is that this bound in this regime is does not hold. It's wrong. It's very easy to check, but the probability that there exists that the connected that the adjacency matrix A, that the graph G has two distinct connected components, is at least n power minus c for some constant c, which depends on d. And in fact, the graph will contain, you can see that the probability that the graph contains a complete d plus 1 regular graph, meaning that a graph with d plus 1 vertices where all edges are present, is of order n power minus c. So on this event, obviously, since there are two connected components, the second there will be two eigenvalues which are equal to d. And so you can lower bound the expectation of the trace just on this event, and you will obtain a bound which, when k is much larger than log n, which is much larger than the bound that you are looking for. Okay? And so the reason, as we see on this counterexample of the d plus 1 complete graph, the reason for the I-trace method, expected I-trace method to fail to be working is due to a presence of only some graphs which are very dense in terms of edges, which are unlikely to occur, but which still have a polynomially small probability to appear. So we will call such bad subgraphs tangles, and I will give you a precise definition later on. So that's the essential difficulty, the proof of Friedman's theorem. So we'll have to refine the strategy. of a Floridian comlodge. So the first step will be to use the non-backlogging matrix instead of the adjacency matrix. Okay, so I will come to this point later on the next slide. Then we will remove this bad bad subgraphs, which we call town loads. And then we will have to project on the trivial eigenspace, which is vectors which have constant coordinates. And only now, as of this fourth stage, we'll be able to use the classical Floridian comlodge method of computing expectation of edges. Okay, so that's the roadmap. So the non-backlogging matrix, I recall you what it is. So it's a matrix indexed by the oriented edge of the graph, and you put a one if between two oriented edges, if the one at entry EF is the endpoint of E is the start point of F, and F is different from the reverse edge of E, Okay. So the for a Dirichlet graph, the number of oriented directed edge is n times d. It's easy to check that the largest eigenvalue will be d minus one, because on each row there is exactly d minus one non-zero entries which are equal to one. And using this spectral correspondences that we discussed last time, in fact, the analog of the equivalent statement. An equivalent statement is in term expressed in terms of Dirichlet graphs. It's just saying that the second largest eigenvalue of the non-backlogging matrix is at most square root of d minus one. Okay, and in fact, that's what Friedman proved. Friedman did not prove directly the Alois conjecture; he proved its non-backlogging version. Okay. Now we will. Rephrase, there is a convenient way to represent at the same time non-backlogging matrices and Dirichlet graph. It's called the configuration model. So the oriented edges, you see them as a set of half edge, if you want, where you so. Which is a pair, an oriented edge is a pair formed by a vertex and the index of an integer between 1 to d, because for your graph is Dirichlet, for each edge, for each vertex you have d oriented edges exiting from it. Okay, and then what you do when you have this collection of oriented edge to build a graph, you consider a matching, so a matching on the set of on this set. V times cross on this set of oriented edges. Okay, so matching is a permutation which is an involution and which has no fixed point. Okay, so as it were, so it matches two edges. So, and if you glue together thanks to this matching the two directed the directed edges, you will obtain a multigraph. Okay, and this multigraph built this way with the matching is called the configuration model. So why is it a multigraph? Because there could be loops or multiple edges, but so it's a graph in a generalized sense. And so what we will do is consider a uniformly sampled random matching. Okay, consider the and then there is a lemma which says that if you condition on the multigraph to be simple, then G sigma, the multigraph you obtain, is uniformly distributed on the set of Dirichlet graph on n vertices. Okay. And luckily, the probability to be simple is lower bounded uniform in n. So in particular, every time that you want to prove a probability an event an event which holds with high probability. On the uniform distribution of the Dirichlet graph, it's enough to prove it for the configuration model. Okay, by using the fact that the probability of being simple is uniformly lower bounded. Okay, so I should have said it, but the configuration model was introduced by Bender and Canfield, and in the at the end of the 70s, and also by Bolobash, but it's not been very clear who is the inventor of this model. But, okay, that's a continuation model anyway. Okay, and now you can also express the configuration, the non-backlogging matrix in terms of its configuration model. So what you do is the non-backlogging matrix acts on the vector space R to the power of the oriented edges, and the entries EF, where E and F are these oriented edges, will be the indicator that your edge is matched to an edge which is adjacent to F, but not F. Okay. So if you think about it, this is exactly this non-backlogging constraint. So you can write it in a matrix form as B times M times N, where M is a permutation matrix associated to the matching. So it's MEF is just is one or zero depending on or not sigma of E is equal to F, and it's zero otherwise. And N of EF is a neighborhood condition on the oriented edges, saying that N of EF is zero if E and is one, sorry, if E and F have the same origin point, so if they are attached to the same vertex, but they are different. Okay. So this way, to restate, you can equivalently define the non-backlogging matrix this way. And it's very nice because it's really tuned to the configuration model. Okay, because M is my, for the configuration model, will be my uniformly sampled permutation matrix. Okay. Right. Okay, so one more step. As we already saw, D minus one is an eigenvalue of the non-backlogging matrix. It's the largest eigenvalue. It's an eigenvalue of B and its transpose, and the corresponding eigenvector is just the eigenvector with constant coordinates. So in particular, the second largest eigenvalue of the non-backlogging matrix is the spectral radius of so the largest eigenvalue in absolute value of B restricted to vectors which are orthogonal to one, so which vectors which whose sum sums to zero. Okay, using the same bound that we used yesterday, you deduce that the operator norm that the spectral radius is bounded by the operator norm. So you deduce that the spectral that mu2 to the L is bounded by the maximum of all vectors which are orthogonal to the constant vector of the norm of B to the of BL of V. Okay, renormalized by the L2 norm of V. Okay. I hope that you follow me up to now. So what we have to do, the Friedman's theorem, we take sigma to be uniform order machining, and we will prove a bound on the Euclidean norm of BL to the V, where V is orthogonal to constant vectors of this form, D minus 1 power L over 2, up to some log n factors, and L will be of order log n. If you put everything together and you use this you will obtain the Friedman's theorem. Okay, so that's our objective. So we know that we cannot directly apply the Furedian Kolmogorov method to study B to the L restricted to the constant vectors, to the vectors orthogonal to the constant, to the vector one. Okay, so we will do a first because due to the presence of these tangles, okay? So what we will do is we will first do a kind of massage of this expression to arrive at a stage where we can use the expected trace method. Okay. So recall that M is adjacent is a permutation matrix of your matching on oriented edges. And N is this neighborhood, relation, which encodes that you are you are same attached vertex, but different. Okay, so we saw that B is N times N. So when you take the power L of B, you can just expand the sum, expand the product in terms of sum of the entries. We already see a similar expansion already. And you get that the sum B to the L, the entry EF, is a sum over a path which you could call a non-backtracking path. So it's a path, sequence of paths of length 2L plus 1. So it's each gamma I is an oriented edge. And the only constraint is that gamma 2S plus 1 have the same attached vertex, but are different. Okay, that's a non-backtracking constraint. So for example, here I have a path, I have a non-backtracking path of length 2. Okay, which would correspond to a sequence of 5 non-backtracking dilated edge. Okay. And then so this is the set gamma L, and you have a product. So this is the set gamma L of EF, which records the starting point and the end point. And then you have a product of all matrix entries, okay, which are this M gamma of 2S minus 1, gamma 2S. Okay, so you check, so this condition is checking whether or not, for example, gamma 1 is matched to gamma 2 by the matching, gamma 3 matched by gamma 4, and so on. Okay, so when you write it this way, you are relatively happy because you have pulled out two different parts. This set gamma L of EF, non-backtracking path of length L from E to F, is independent of sigma, okay? It does not depend on the underlying graph. Okay, you just have, it's just a non-backtracking constraint which is encoded here. So it's a combinatorial part. The summand, which is this product of the permutation of the entries of the permutation matrices, depends on sigma, and this is this the product is random. So we are exactly as in what we did previously, where we are summing a large deterministic set and with weights which were random, okay? And here you have an example, a longer example of such sequence, an element of gamma of EL, gamma L of EF for L, I don't know, 7 or 8 or something like that. Okay. Okay, so we will start with the bad idea. The bad idea, but natural from a algebraic point of view, since we are interested by looking at the spectral radius of B to the L in the orthogonal of the constant vector, we could try to project, we can simply project this matrix on constant vectors. Okay, so the projection of the permutation matrix M on the constant vector is simply M minus 1 transpose divided by N over T. Okay, and what you get is that the orthogonal of B, B restricted to the orthogonal projection on constant vectors is simply M bar, this M underline, this M bar times N. Okay. Okay, whose powers has exactly the same form as powers of B, except that the sum is over the same sets of non-backtracking paths of length L, but the difference is that now you take this product of, you can think of that, of recentered permutation matrices. Okay, this M bar gamma of 2S minus 1. Okay, the problem is that due to the presence of these tangles, these subgraphs which creates the expected I-trace method to fail, we will not use this matrix, this projected matrix B bar, but we will first remove the tangles and then do this projection. So that's what I explain now. Okay, so this is an important definition. I'm not sure. So this definition appeared in a few papers. I'm not sure about the origin of this definition, but this is a very nice idea. Observation, and so a multigraph or a path So by multigraph, bypass, I mean the property of the graph spanned by the graph associated to the path will be tangle free if it contains at most one cycle. Okay. So one is not so important here. You could put two, three, or so one works for the Friedmann's theorem, but so a tangle free means that you have at most one cycle. And you say that a graph or a path is L tangle free if all vertices have at most one cycle in their L neighborhood. Okay, so if you grow a ball of radius L around any vertex, what you will see is at most one cycle. Okay, so what we do is we consider, instead of looking at all non-backtracking paths of length L between two vertices, we call F of L of EF the set of tangle-free non-backtracking paths. Okay, so it's a smaller set. And this smaller set, we will work with this smaller set. And this is just the only trick in the proof. So the observation is that if your graph is L tangle free and you consider a power of the non-backtracking matrix B, okay, then this matrix B coincides with another matrix B with which I denote by B with parenthesis K, okay, so which is not the K-th power of the matrix B, but something closely related but different. When you just take the same sum, the product of the permutation matrices M, but you restrict your sum to tangle-free paths which are tangle-free. Why is it true? Because if your graph is L tangle-free, then if you see the B power K is a sum over all non-backtracking paths, but if your path is not tangle-free, the summand will be zero. Okay? So you have this identity, this equality between two matrices if your graph is L tangle-free and K is less than L. Okay, so again, this is due to the fact that if you take a path which is not backtracking but tangled, not tangle-free, then by definition of the fact that your graph is L tangle-free, the product of the M of the gammas will be zero, because otherwise there would be, if it's one, it means that there is a path in the graph, and so you will have found two cycles. It's a contradiction. Okay, so that's the only trick, but this is a crucial trick. And now what we will do is we want to project on the orthogonal of the constant vector. So what we introduce this projected matrix with codes, because it's not exact, which is the same as B, but we B power K parentheses, but it's a B underline B bar parenthesis K. Where you take the sum over the same sets of tangle-free non-backtracking paths, but now you take the product of the recentered entries. Okay. Unfortunately, B, it's complicated to say it, but you can see it visually. The k-th power of B bar is different from this new matrix. Okay. But it's approximately true. Why is it different? Because it's the same summand, but they sum over a different set. Okay, so what we will do is to try to project manually the matrix and see that this identity is not true, but it's approximately true. So the rest of the computation is not very fancy, but it's probably worth to see it once. So you write that M, the non-centered matrix, is M is a centered matrix plus 1 over N over D, N 1 over ND. Okay, so using a telescopic sum decomposition, you expand brutally, and you obtain the following expression for the power of B power of BL in terms of this recentered matrix, B bar L. Okay, so you obtain B bar L and a sum of terms, each of them comes with a a term of order 1/n d. Okay, so if you look at this expression slightly more carefully, you sum over all paths, a double free path of length L. For the first k minus one steps, you take the product of the recentered entries, and for the L minus k last steps, you take the products of the non-centered entries. Okay. So then you decompose the tangle-free path into three paths, a path of length k minus one, gamma prime, a path of length, tangle-free path of length one, and a tangle-free path of length L minus k, okay? In the obvious way. So then you can reinterpret this sum using the fact that the number of tangle-free paths of length one is d minus one. It's the same as the number of tangle of non-backlogging paths. Okay, so this sum that you are interested in, you can write it as non-backtracking paths, the non-backlogging matrices of smaller order, of smaller powers, up to this one star, but there will be remainder terms, okay? Because if you look at the expression with the products of the two non-backtracking matrices, b bar power k minus one and b bar L minus k. What you are considering, if you expand this, you are considering paths, okay, tangle-free paths, one of them of k minus one of them of length L minus k. But even if each of them is tangle-free, their union is not necessarily tangle-free. So you have to add an error matrix which sums the very same products over tangle-free paths whose union is tangled. Okay, so you have the three different possibilities. On the below, you see three pictures of tangle-free. Each subpath is tangle-free at most one cycle, but their union is tangled. Okay, meaning that the union has two distinct cycles. Okay. So once you are here, so I just reproduce the same identity. You have almost done your orthogonal projection. You use the fact that if your graph is tangle-free, then you can remove the parenthesis. B power L minus K parenthesis is the same as B power L minus K. Okay, we already saw this identity. And we use the fact that one is the left eigenvectors of B. Okay, and so if V is orthogonal to one, as a constant eigenvector, you will obtain that the sum in the middle will vanish. Okay, so what you are back to is that if V is orthogonal to the constant vector, B to the L of V is B bar to the L of V, minus, so this would be exact if we had done the proper an exact orthogonal projection, but there is an error term, which is this sum of remaining terms, which counts paths which are tangled, right? So finally, you obtain that you can bound the second largest eigenvalue, non-backtracking eigenvalue, in terms of operator norms of two matrices. So the first one would be this recentered tangle-free non-backtracking matrix plus remainder terms. So it's true if your graph is L tangle-free and easy to check lemma that L will be L tangle-free in the case of the configuration model where you take uniformly random matching, your graph will be L tangle-free with L, which is a small constant in terms of when L is a further log N with a small constant in front. Okay. So I reproduce the same inequality, which is very nice. So now we have, at the same time, we have done the first, the step two and three of the program. We have recentered the entries. This is because the entries of B are recentered. We have, and we have removed the tangles. okay? Tangles are graphs, this path which visits at least two distinct cycles. Okay, so now since we have done that, we are in position to do the expected iTrace method methodology. So we'll study the norm, for example, the norm of B underscore L by bounding its norm by the by taking a power of this matrix to a large number k and bounding it by the expectation of the trace. Okay. So since it's the same as the Floridian Kolmogorov strategy on the overall, but so we bound the second largest eigenvalue of the non-backtracking matrix by looking expectation contribution of some passes in the graph, okay? But and the total length of the pass are of order k times 2k times l, okay? Because b bar l consider pass non-backtracking tangle-free pass of length l, and when you take power k of such 2k of such matrices, you will get on the overall pass of length 2lk. Okay, so L will be of order log n, and K of order log n over log n. So on the overall, we'll have pass of length log n squared divided by log n, which is much larger than log n, which is consistent with the fact that we know that to be able to control operator norm of spectral radius, we must consider pass of length much larger than log n. Okay, so we are on a safe ground. Okay, so I will just, I will not tell you how you prove that, but I will just tell you, we have seen all ingredients, essentially all ingredients for the proof. When you take the non-backtracking matrix B bar power L, so you take the trace of this matrix time hits transpose power k, you will sum paths which are like this flower I've drawn, and these paths are made of 2k paths, each of them is of length l, and each of them is a tangle free non-backtracking path. Okay, and the summand is the expectation of the product of the recentered products of the permutation matrices of all the edges, the weights that you've seen on the path. Okay, so as we have seen for the Floridian Kolmogorov strategy, we can bound using the fact that the paths are tangle free, you are able to bound the number of such paths with a given genus and a given number of vertices, and your bound is good enough. The fact that your bound works is due to the fact you use crucially the fact that each of the paths gamma I visits at most one distinct cycle. He can visit many times the same cycles, but at most one cycle. Okay. And the probabilistic part is to estimate the expectation of the product of the matrix entries. Okay, so now the matrix is not exactly recentered. The expectation of M bar of EF is not exactly zero, but it's close to be zero. And more importantly, the entries of the permutation matrices are not independent. So there is a lemma which estimates product of recentered entries, expectation of products of recentered entries, which is of this form. If you take any sets of two capital T pairs of oriented edges, and you look at the expectation of the product of the M of ETFT minus 1 over the N, okay, so the M bar of F of ETFT, it's bounded in expectation by 1 over the N power the number of distinct unordered pairs that you see. Okay, this is okay because the probability of this term 1 over tn power a is quite natural, because the probability of m of et ft to be 1 is essentially 1 over dn. So the fact that you have 1 over dn power a is natural. Okay, and then you have the second term, which is an important term, which is very important, which would make the proof work, is that you tend to visit, it's a 3t divided by square root of dn. So this term, the only important thing is that this 3t divided by square root of dn is a small, when t is much larger than dn, square root of dn. And power a1, where a1 is a number of pairs, okay, that you visit in the video, the number of pairs, or this unordered pairs ETFT, which appears exactly once. So this A1, you see here the fact that your entries are essentially recentered. Okay, so here you see the effect of the fact that you are recentering the entries. Okay, so you remember when we are dealing with Wigner matrices, so with independent entries, which were centered, it was very important that the contribution that we were summing paths would visit each edge at least twice. Okay, so here you are allowed to visit an edge only once, but if you visit an edge only once, you will have a small contribution exactly due to the fact that 3t divided by square root of dn will be much will be small. Okay. So the proof I presented you is in this preprinted archive, and the idea of this past decomposition dates back to there is a prehistorical form of this idea in a paper by Laurent Massoulier in 2014. Okay. So now, in the few minutes which remains, I would like to give you just other statements which can be reached by similar strategies. So the first one is very natural. Is we come back to our Wigner matrices, the sparse Wigner matrices. So we specify to the adjacency matrix of Herder-Schrödinger graph, and we look at what happens when the average degree is fixed. And we will consider the non-backtracking spectrum, because the adjacency spectrum is not so interesting in terms of largest eigenvalues in this regime. We already saw that the largest eigenvalues of the adjacency matrix are just comparable to the square root of the largest degrees. Okay, so if you make a simulation of the eigenvalues of an Herder-Schrödinger graph of average degree 4 and 500 vertices, you consider the eigenvalues of the non-backtracking matrix, you see this beautiful picture. So you see that there is an eigenvalue around 4, which is the average degree, and all other ones seems to be in a ball, in a disk of radius at square root of 4, which is 2. Okay. So this is true. There is a theorem for that. That this largest eigenvalue will be t, and this all the others that will be at most square root t. So the condition mu2 less than square root d can be understood as a Ramanujan property, meaning that it is possible to prove that the spectral radius of the non-backtracking operator of the universal covering tree of Gn, so it's a random object, it's essentially a Galton-Watson tree with Poisson offspring distribution D, but the non-backtracking operator of this random tree is its spectral radius is square root D. So it's exactly a Ramanujan property for the non-backtracking matrix. Okay, so there is an analog result when you consider inhomogeneous Herder-Schrödinger random graphs, which is with a finite number of classes. So it's a stochastic block model, it's called. But I will not. This was the main motivation of my co-authors, but I will not mention it. Mention more this connection here. And one word about the proof. We use essentially the same strategy. The problem that we have here is that the past decomposition that I just presented for the Dirichlet graph is much more involved because the eigenvector associated to the largest eigenvalue, mu1, is random. And the left eigenvector and the right eigenvector are different. So you have to introduce further ideas, and it's much more probabilistic. But the combinatorial part of it, the tangle-free path, the counting of the trace, expected trace method at the end, is the same. Okay. Another example of application of expected iTrace method combined with tangle-free path and non-backtracking matrices is the following one. Consider Q distinct permutations, sigma 1 up to sigma k, permutation on the set of first n integers, okay, permutation in Sn, and call Si their permutation matrices. So 0, 1 matrices where you put a 1 if between x, y, if sigma I of x is 1. Then for a given polynomial, so non-commutative polynomial is just a word. You can think of that as just a word in the Si. You consider the matrix that you can form by taking any word in the Si and the Si transpose. Star is conjugate transpose. Okay, for example, I've given you two examples. And the second one, if you take S1 plus S2 plus S1 star plus S2 star, you can see that as the adjacency matrix of a four regular graph or multigraph. Okay, because this is a 0, 1 matrix with four elements. It's a symmetric matrix with the row sum and the column sum is exactly four on each line. Okay, so this is a, so this problem is in some sense more general than the Friedman's theorem, which we just treated. Okay, now we consider not only things which are any linear combination of the SI, but in fact, it need not be linear, it can be any polynomial. Okay. So since the SI is an eigenvector of all permutation matrices, then the constant vector is an eigenvector of P and P star. Okay. The non-trivial, the first non-trivial eigenvalue of P will be the operator. So the operator norm of P on the orthogonal of the constant vector is simply the norm of P of F when you take F to be orthogonal to the constant vector. Okay, so what we want to understand is the value of this number when n is large. So it's n when the sigma I are uniform, independent, should have written independent, sorry, uniform, independent random permutation. Okay, so you see that by forming all these polynomials, why is it interesting? By forming all these polynomials, we are interested by the algebra generated by permutation matrices, okay? And we are interested by, so this algebra, we can look at it in many ways, and the natural way is to consider the strong convergence of this algebra, meaning the convergence in operator norm of the operator norms of the elements in this algebra. So that's exactly the question that we are dealing with here, okay? So if we need a limit algebra, and this limit algebra is the free group. So the free group with Q generators, so you take Q generators, you call them G1 up to GK, you consider their inverses, so it gives you two Q elements, and the free group means simply that the generators have, they do not commute and they do not have any specific relation, so you can see the free group, represent the K graph of the free groups spanned by these GIs as an infinite 2Q regular tree. Okay, so it's an algebra of worlds, if you want. It's a group of worlds in the GIs. Okay, so you can associate the free group is a countable as a countable number of elements. So you can associate an operator on L2 of X, which is the same. You take your polynomial, and instead of taking the permutation matrices, I take another unitary elements, which are just the multiplication by the left multiplication operators by each of the generators of the free group. Okay, so I take the same polynomial, but instead of considering the permutation as I did previously, I consider the operation which multiply on the left by the GI. Okay, this is note that this is also a bijection. This operation of left multiplication is a bijection on X. Okay. Sorry, there is a French didn't compile properly. Sorry. So there is a theorem with Benoît Collins which says that the number that we are looking for, the operator norm, is the orthogonal of the constant functions of when you take independent uniform permutation. When n goes to infinity, it converges to the operator norm on the same polynomial, but on the free group. Okay, so this is called the strong asymptotic freeness. Can I have 2 minutes? Okay, so 2 minutes. So I just sketched for you the strategy, the 2 slides. So it's just, there is a wonderful trick which says that if you can, instead of considering all polynomials, it's enough to consider symmetric linear polynomials with matrix coefficients. So it means that instead of looking at P, you consider a matrix A, which is A in zero plus the sum of AI tensor product with the SI, where AI are matrices which are of size K by K, K is fixed. Okay? And the AI star, and the AI star is the conjugate transpose of AI, where I star is the index of the permutation, which is the inverse of it. Okay? Because I have to consider the SI and the SI transpose. Okay, so AI star is the index of SI star. Okay, and the linearization trick says that if you know that the spectra of all these matrices converge, it automatically implies the convergence of the spectra of all non-commutative polynomials. Okay, so instead, so at the cost of adding matrix valued coefficients, which are these A's, I's, to solve this apparently complicated problem of any non-commutative polynomial, it is enough to consider the apparently simpler problem, to consider things which are linear in terms of the SI. So that's why it's called the linearization trick. And then, without surprise, you define the non-backtracking version of these matrices A, and by this extension of this Hashian Moto Ir Abbas identities, you obtain that if you can compute the spectral radii of all non-backtracking matrices, it will automatically imply the convergence of the spectrum of the A's that you are interested in. And to prove the convergence of the spectral radii of the non-backlogging matrices, more or less, you use the same strategy than the one sketched for you for the Friedmann's theorem. Here, of course, you have weights, which you have matrix value. We have these matrices AIs, which makes the proof more complicated, but the strategy globally is the same. Okay, so maybe I will shoot this remark. So I hope that I will have convinced you that trace methods are interesting and they are able to prove non-trivial statements. I think that the advantage of trace methods is that they are very robust. They don't need anything to They are very versatile. Essentially, any problem you can try to attack it with a trace type method, and they are especially useful when you deal with matrices with a few randomness and matrices which are very sparse. And they are especially nice because they connect, notably when you look at non-backtracking matrices. You see very directly the link between spectrum and the geometry of the graph, because you the geometry of your underlying matrix, because you are really looking at paths which are counting. You are really counting a weighted path. Okay. So okay, that's all. And do not hesitate to contact me if you have questions or if you have remarks on anything. Or I didn't tell you, but there are still many questions which have not been solved in this domain. So if you want some open problems, I can send it to you, some of them if you want. Okay, thank you for your attention.